So thank you, everyone. Today we're going to hear from Costin, who's a senior staff scientist at Berkeley Lab in the research division. And he's going to tell us about some tuning floating point precision. And I should just point out to everyone that I think everyone is, but if you are not the speaker, please be sure to mute yourself. And as a reminder, this is being recorded. Okay. All you, Costin.
All right. Thank you for the introduction. Thank you for taking the time to tune in. I hope you're going to enjoy the talk. If there are questions, just interrupt me and ask. This is the talk for you. What I'm going to report is the results of a year-long NERSC-CRD collaborative project that looks at the application data precision tuning. You have your simulation. It is written using 64-bit double precision floating point data, and all the operations are in double. For performance reasons or because you want to use some of the new hardware coming online, you may want to modify this application to use single precision data or even narrower width data types. And this is what we looked at. We looked at the set of methodologies that can enable you to do this type of transformations. What's going on here? All right. So the project has started with this idea to assemble a cookbook for tuning the floating point precision of full applications. And the emphasis is in full applications. And I'll show you why this is actually a very important distinction. If you look, there are multiple directions or lines of reasoning you need to be aware of and be able to manipulate your programs. The first one is reasoning about precision, error causes, and causality. We did not actively work in this area. We had a group of students last summer that did a survey. We identified sort of the main directions, a set of useful tools that we can actually apply to our codes. And we compiled the report, and the tools are still installed at NERSC. The area we've been working actively is how to actually do the transformation themselves. These techniques are gonna be the bulk of the talk. We came up with a tool. We took that tool and we actually applied it to a couple of NISEP codes, CCTBX and PeleC, with decent results, and we actually gained a lot of insight both on our side of the computer science side of the transformations and what the application people expectations actually are, okay? And we have a bunch of very good ideas how to proceed. I'm gonna talk about this at the end of the talk. This is the list of the people that contributed to all this work. It's been a pleasure working on all of them, and looks like we're gonna continue doing this for the at least foreseeable future, 1 or 2 years from now. The first topic is reasoning about the precision. And this is a fascinating area. There's a lot of theoretical work in numerical analysis and program analysis. What we did was we looked for tools that have a software implementation that can solve and ask a useful, give you the answer to an useful question, okay? We identified sort of three main directions. One is tools that can identify error root causes and causality. The other one is the tools that can sort of predict the error of a program and maybe give you some notion of sensitivity analysis. And the third direction is tools that can sort of give you, propose inputs to you that may exercise your coding in ways you didn't think before, and that exposes fragilities in the code. As I said, the emphasis was actionable software implementation. All this area of reasoning about error is actually very challenging for multiple reasons. This is the output output of one of the tools I was talking to. And as you can see, so the red dots show you where rounding error occurs. The red arcs show you sort of causality between these, and the yellow arcs show you the full causality analysis. And it looks like a spaghetti plate. So it is a really complicated problem to understand the global view. And the reason is floating point errors have a bunch of characteristics. So they're non-compositional. By that, we mean, let's say you have a very large error at some program point, you keep running, that error may be hidden by other errors, cancellation or overflow or whatever it is. So it disappears and you don't see its contribution in the output. Another characteristic is that these errors are non-local. You see an error at some program point, the real cause may have happened way before in the execution, and it's very hard to figure out the causality between these things. And the third characteristic is that these errors are non-uniform. And this means the metric or the error behavior changes based on the input values. And for example, this doesn't happen in integer codes. You have a one over whatever, iteration error, that happens no matter what the iteration is, okay? This doesn't happen in floating point values. As a corollary to that, this means you need to adjust your error metrics or error measures depending on the input. And this slide shows you two ways to think about errors. You use either the absolute value or the relative value. The absolute error or the relative error. And based on the range, either is good in a different regime. So, absolute value, if your numbers are large towards infinity, that's not a good metric. Relative error, if your numbers are close to zero, it's not a good metric in that area. Because of that, the metric has to be adapted based on the values. And on top of that, if you look at the tools, all of them tend to cook up their own metric. And you really need to pay attention and understand what the metric does, because a lot of them are, I found them not intuitive, and it's hard to figure out what the sort of the operational value of them is. The first tool that I'm going to present is Herbrind, which you can use to find the root causes of errors. It is a binary instrumentation based, runs on top of Herbrind. Because of that, it's kind of generic, and they showed that it runs on C++ and Fortran code. The biggest application I've seen is like 60,000 lines of code. Yeah, so it's decent and it actually gives you good results. Underneath, it uses a trace-based approach using shadow values and shadow analysis, combined with a lot of data flow, control flow analysis, and symbolic analysis. Shadow values means during the tracing, they execute every single operation in all the precisions available, and they record all the possible values. And then they run all the analysis on the trace, and they can make very, very powerful inferences. This is a sample of what Herbrind can report for you. The program on the left runs the main function on this set of inputs. And this report says there is a problem on this line. So there's a possible error on this line. And this is how the report looks like. And the good things about here is it identifies the problematic statement. It tells you what the ranges are for the problematic inputs based on what it has seen. And then it also can give you an example problem input. And this is useful information if you want to understand the numerical behavior of your codes. It also does causality. This shows you how the causality graph looks like. We've used this tool, we find it useful, but you have to be patient and understand that it is very verbose, okay? The second tool I'm gonna talk about is ADAPT. This comes from our friends at Livermore. And what it does, it estimates the output error and sort of sensitivity of the codes. On the right-hand side, you have a report for Lulesh. And what that says is everything that's red based on their analysis needs to be executed in double precision. What is green can be probably lowered to single. And I have a strong feeling that the gradient gives you the likelihood of that succeeding. Underneath, they use automatic differentiation, and that's actually a very useful technique to understand what it does. Turns out that they use multiple tools depending on the code, that's what Kodi pair for C++ or TAPNet for C Fortran. They run it on a bunch of benchmarks, Lulesh, HPCG. So it seems that it can handle scientific codes. Algorithmic differentiation, powerful technique, probably you should understand what it does. So it computes the derivative of a program from first principles. And it does this by applying this chain rule, the derivative chaining rule, and knowing how to compute the derivative of every single arithmetic operation. So this graph here shows you how they compute the automatic differentiation for this sequence of statements. So they compute it for the plus, then they feed it into the second multiply and so on. As a rule, I think there's two ways to do this algorithmic differentiation. If you go, if your inputs are larger than your output, I think you go forward, and I think that's called tangent. If your inputs are same order or larger than your, if your outputs are same order or larger than your inputs, you go backwards, and I think that's called the computing the adjoint. You can take the algorithmic differentiation, and that's what they do, and they do error estimation using it, and this kind of shows you how they do it. So each statement, they approximate it with a first order Taylor. This is the formula that they use for the estimating the output of that part, the error of that particular statement using automatic differentiation. And they put it together. You can make your own conclusion how accurate this is, okay? This technique, so by predicting the output error, they can figure out, they can run sensitivity analysis. And this is a report on HPCG. Again, red is double, green is single. So this is what the type of report they can do. And then based on this, they went and did the modifications by hand to these applications. And for example, this graph shows you the error sensitivity for HPCG on the variable. So this, you solve A x equals B for X. And they show you the sensitivity on the of the error. And what this graph says, and it's actually a useful insight, is, for example, HPCG, you got to start in high precision double, and you can relax the precision at the end, okay? And this is kind of contrary to the intuition of a lot of other approaches that people are using for floating point tuning, which they do the opposite. They try to start in single and then increase the precision towards the end, okay? So this shows you there's a lot of ways, and codes behave very differently, and you really need to understand what the code is doing. The third technique is this input generation technique. They have a technique that proposes to you inputs that maximize the floating point error. It's very good for software engineering and for debugging. I'm not gonna go in detail about this. It is important to understand how they do it. So if you do testing, you do this random testing, you pick a bunch of random inputs by good randomization. The hope is you get very good program coverage. So that works for a lot of programs. Floating point, again, is special. So what they do is they take the random inputs, and then they take inputs close to the first random sample. And then they look at the differences between, so if there's error between two inputs that are close by, they go over sample in that area. And this is how they give you better coverage, and they can propose interesting inputs to you. This is a slide that says their approach is a lot more generic than other techniques are, like interval arithmetic, fine arithmetic, or SMT, which people are, these are techniques that people are using to generate inputs. And they show you some sample programs where they are better. What you should take from this slide is those sample programs kind of tell you what the complexity of the programs they handle is, okay? This is a slide that summarizes their results and they do better on a lot of metrics than other techniques. They ran it on QRD composition and LU, but I think these are references, like the textbook implementations that are actually quite simple underneath. In terms of the summary, so we had all these tools, we tried, all of them have high overhead, and it's actually a reasonably steep learning curve. A lot of them require manual changes. Herbrand is actually has my endorsement this far, so it's the easiest to use, and it actually is, I think, is the most powerful and the most robust. It is very useful for you to understand the first principles that they use. And that allows you, if you want to debug and understand numerically what your code does, I think that's very useful. All of them are somewhat limited in scalability. We spend a line trying to use these tools to our own codes. And we started with CCTBX, which is Python plus C plus CUDA. And then there was a lot of engineering to get it running in this environment. We did it last summer. As an aside, I think automatic differentiation is useful. I wouldn't personally use the tools that Adept is using right now. So there's a new LLVM pass built by this guy, Bill Moses. He was here last summer as well. It's robust, scales, it's very good. And being LLVM, it's generic, so C++ Fortran. So that would be my favorite these days. So this concludes the summary of the error tools to reason about the error behavior. We install them at NERSC. If you want to use them, they are still there. Some of them, at least Herbgram, probably evolved since, so we can maintain it for you. If you have questions, I'm still collaborating with the people that did the survey, so we still have the expertise to use them. So come talk to us if you have questions. So that concludes the error reasoning about errors and brings me to the actual techniques that can affect change and do the actual precision tuning for your application. The reason to do that is the fact that in the post-Moore era, we cannot get performance by better process fabrication anymore. So that forced us to think about architectural innovation, and one path to get good performance is through hardware specialization. And what this hardware specialization does is they do fixed function or some domain specific, which is kind of multiple fixed function units that operate on usually on narrow data types. And if you can use this specialized hardware well, you can increase the throughput of arithmetic intensive codes and then increase performance automatically. And by using the narrow data types, you can you reduce the data movement energy and also indirectly increase performance. So specialized hardware is already here in some incarnation. So the best example is that there's 9 nodes that have the tensor cores in. And this graph kind of shows you the promise of the performance promise. So the first 3 lines here show you the DGM performance if you execute it on the GPU. And the top line here, it shows you the DGM performance if you execute it on the tensor cores. Much higher, this is because they use narrower data types. Number one, and it's actual, the architecture is you do this 4x4 matrix, multiplies a lot of them in parallel. So there's a lot of incentive to reduce, to use this, for example, this tensor cores. And this is actually how the project started. Okay, there's incentive to use a tensor cores. Let's figure out how do we refactor and port codes to this tensor cores. There have already been efforts, and there's already good precedent why you want to use them. This slide shows you some work done by Dongara's group. This is ELU factorization. The graph on the left shows you the performance of the, I think, the main routine there, implemented in different precisions. And one thing to take from this graph is the differences in performance between the different precisions are kind of very close to the differences in performance when you look at the peak numbers, okay? Now, you take these, turns out that you cannot just plug them as is in the application. What they end up doing is they start in single or whatever, lower precision. So they have this adaptive algorithm. They can start in low and graduate to double, and they have a patching passing somewhere in the middle. And this table here shows you results on a bunch of real inputs. The couple of lessons here. It does improve performance to some good degree. So we can, tensor cores are good for arithmetic intensive codes. The other lesson here is the end-to-end performance, if you look at the whole application run, is a lot less, it's not proportional anymore to the peak values. So there we need techniques that can tell us ahead of time and fast what is the real expectation improvement if you were to do the precision tuning on a code, okay? And this is actually one of the problems we are trying, we kind of solve with, I'll show you, I'll show a little later. These other application shows you what the gains are in terms of data movement. So this is some sort of Kublas implementation where they cook up their own floating point representation, and they do that by chopping Mantissa bits. So they keep in main memory the data in this compressed format, and then when they move it like this to the GPU, they expand it, and then they do the Kublas kernels. You make your own inference if that's sound or numerically sound or, but this graph shows you that if you do this, you get the performance improvements from reducing the data movement. So the blue is the real Kublas, the yellow is their implementation. The larger the matrix, the higher the performance they get. So this is a direct demonstration that by reducing the data width and going to single precision, you get performance improvements as well, okay? And better, probably also better energy. If you put this together, and if you are very lucky choosing a very friendly domain problem, and any AI and ML, any computation that does probabilistic results is ripe for this precision tuning, you can say precision tuning is an enabler for exascale. And this is the work that's been done at NERSC can show the exascale performance results for climate modeling. So all these application experiences, I hope that by now they convinced you that considering precision tuning may give you some benefits, at least in terms of performance. So now the question is, you have an application, how do you really go about it? And you can break it into two problems. Identify your kernels, figure out what kernel do I need to accelerate. You accelerate the kernel, and then you gotta think about, okay, now how do I put this kernel back in the full application context? And there's a lot of work in how to accelerate kernels. There's less work thinking about how do you refactor and you put it back in the whole application context. And that's why we focused and we took the path I'm gonna describe later. Overall, if you think about what the solutions are to these two questions, it turns out it's all about selecting the search space and the search strategy. By selecting a search space, I mean, you gotta figure out, okay, what do I wanna modify? Let's say I wanna modify the variables. I wanna change the type from double to single. That's your search space, okay? Search strategy is I selected the variables, how do I get to modify this in the least, in an experimental whatever strategy with the least number of steps, for example. When you think about refactoring, it's the same problem, but turns out that you have to really tailor your search space and the search strategy in order to be refactoring friendly. And I'll show you how. So Hugo built this tool called PyFlot that kind of, you give it a code and discovers a tuning strategy to choose between multiple alternate implementations of a given function. In full application settings, it can provide you sort of a cookbook or sketch of a strategy how to do the refactoring. And I think most and foremost is very useful because it can give you upper bounds on the performance expectations, okay? Before I describe what the tool does, let's understand what the search space is, how do we build it, and what are the trade-offs. So the code here shows you, I think it's Newton methods applied to Kepler's equation. So it computes the position of the Earth while going around the sun. There are multiple ways to figure out what this search space is, all right? The first attempts and the first automatic tools that have been introduced, they looked at modifying assembly instructions. And in this case, the example is we take the assembly instruction that performs that minus operation and If it was double, you try to do it single. The granularity is too fine, so this type of approach kind of ran out of favor. The second type of approach is trying to modify the program variables directly, and this is a lot more powerful and relates a lot easier to the code source. And incidentally, this is something we are guilty of and we introduced. There's a tool called Parsimonious. And if I remember it correctly, Jim Demel had the original idea, let's try to tune precision variables, and the rest of us figured out how. The point here is you really need to be cognizant of the number of the variables. And this can blow very easily for very large codes. Because for example, with 10 variables, if you really want to be thorough, you have to test 1,000 combinations. So you need to run a kind of 1,000 experiments if you want to be thorough. So Parsimonious is still alive. It inspired a lot of follow-on work, and they're actually going to use it soon. After Parsimonious, the next sort of type of approach is a look at loop iterations, okay? So what they do is they say, I have loops. I want to figure out how many iterations I can run in the lowest precision or whatever, in single versus double, okay? And they have methodology that does that, okay? As a rule, no matter what your search space is, what the primitives are, loop iterations, variables, or instructions, at this level, one of the design goals is you may want to minimize the number of search elements, but as you'll see later, this is actually quite a subtle problem, because by minimizing the number, you kind of increase the granularity of the code coverage of that element. So the easiest way to think about this is, if I take a variable and if I make it a global, if I change it, that affects a lot of code. If it's local, affects less, okay? So you gotta be careful about the trade-off between number of elements and the granularity, okay? And this is one of the things we are doing. So we figured out what the right way to pick this is. The other component is the search strategy. And I'm gonna show you an example. So in Parsimonious, we introduced this sort of delta debugging binary search strategy. You have the code here. I'm gonna show you a detailed example how it runs. As a rule, and what I want to say here. So I think we're going to show you, there's a lot more room for improvement in improvement or innovation, how you choose the search space rather than the search strategy. Because if you choose the search space smart, the search strategy kind of follows. I may be wrong, maybe room for innovation in this area as well, but remains to be seen, all right? So this is how when thinking about the search strategy, the design goal is you want to minimize the number of steps to solution. So you don't want to do brute force search or combinatorial search unless you really know what you are doing. You want to do the least number of experiments, because every experiment means recompile, try a lot of other things, okay? So this is an example that shows you how we do that in Parsimonious. So this is delta debugging binary search. You start with all your program has all your variables in a double precision. You wanna get to lower as many as them or change the type to as many of them into single precision, all right? So it goes like binary search, okay? You take your space, you have it, you put half in single, half in double. You run the experiment, see what the program says, okay? If you can accept the result of the program. In this particular example, both trials fail. So you gotta go put whatever you put in single, you gotta put some of them back in double. And again, binary search, this binary search nature, you go halves again, you put half back, and you rerun the experiment. In this scenario, the left-hand side of the tree fails, the right-hand side succeeds, you pick one. So this is already a partial solution. So you freeze it. So this means I'm gonna keep this in single because I know all the runs are gonna succeed. And now you're gonna go see if you can lower the rest of the red. Okay, so again, you go halves, you run experiments. In this case, the leftmost one succeeds. You freeze with the rest. it's another better partial solution, and you keep going until you fail. And then the algorithm returns saying, okay, this is the proposed configuration. So there's some implicit things here which are actually quite quite subtle and affect things later on. As you can see, the traversal strategy and the solution you reach is kind of determined by the original ordering of your input set, okay? And for example, in our approach, we kind of fix this ordering based on the performance impact of these search items, or however you want to call them, all right? The other thing that's subtle, and we had some back and forth discussions, is all the algorithms have this implicit assumption that if you, there's some sort of monotonicity and not a very high correlation between these variables, meaning that if you try the strategy and commit it to it, there's no point in backtracking and going back up the tree, okay? You do this to get faster to a solution, you may lose like efficacy, so you may lose better solutions, okay? So the state of the art, as I said, instructions, scalar variables, or single loop iterations, okay? And most of the tools, I think, you'll find that if you try to use them, you'll find that they handle only small pieces of code. You cannot really apply these tools to a full application. Parsimonious, I already mentioned it, and there's some follow-on work there. Searches on scalar variables. There's something that's similar, well, not similar, fancier than Parsimonious, is called GPU Mixer. Comes from LLVM, and it allows you to tune CUDA kernels based on some notion of data flow. Very Carlo searches on loop iterations, and Flowsmith looks like searches on binary instrumentations. Ourselves, we're gonna use this summer Parsimonious and GPU Mixer, and I'll show you why or how. If there are questions, I think Hugo, which is online, understands these tools a lot better than I do, because I think at least he may have played hands-on, and at least he read the papers in a lot of detail. Anyhow, this was a state of the art. Turns out that if you think about full application refactoring, there are still a lot of open problems, which turns out that I think that it's very important to solve them. So number one, our scientific codes, they don't really work on scalars, they work on arrays. So we need to figure out a strategy that reasons about arrays, okay? And array regions and so on. The other one is, if you wanna do this refactoring for specialized hardware, you're gonna end up with the function implemented, your primitives are gonna be actual function implementations, okay? DGEMs or whatever the hardware does, okay? So we need a strategy that's able to search around function implementations, okay? On top of that, if you wanna do proper application refactoring, it can become a complicated software engineering problem. And whatever decision you make during the designing these algorithms, they better be refactoring friendly, okay? And the example here is like this. I do that binary search, okay? Let's say I do that binary search I showed you on loop iterations, I end up with this kind of fragmented space, okay? That says red is double, green is single, okay? Go back, figure out how to put this back in the application. Maybe there's not such easy correlation, yeah? As opposed to this one that says beginning one precision, contiguous, and then the end. This is the second proposal is probably easier to refactor, okay? And one thing to understand here is what we focused, and this is gonna come over and over into the discussion is, we use a lot of indirect solvers. They do have an iterative structure. Well, what we wanna do is exploit this iterative structure to drive the precision tuning and preserve it so we can refactor easily, okay? So this is how we designed, this is one of the basic ideas around which we designed our approaches. The third angle is you kind of want a performance-driven approach. By that I mean it's a hard problem. you don't want to work a lot and figure out you don't get any performance benefits. So we want something that is little work, a lot less work, and that can give you an estimate of on the performance benefits you may get, okay? And then that hopefully motivates you to actually go do the hard work. And the third aspect is, you saw it's a combinatorial search on very expensive experiments. You wanna do it in a bounded amount of time. So that means a scalable search. So this is the tool we built. The assumption is we targeted it directly for refactoring for the tensor cores. The assumption there is when you start with your code, you're gonna refactor it to do small degens because that's what the tensor core does. And then it can give you a strategy that can tell you, okay, how many of these degens or which of them can you execute in single or how many you need to keep in double, okay? So the tool sort of automatically discovers a tuning strategy for choosing between these multi-versioned function implementations. It can propose or it can guide you to tell you what the refactoring places should be. And most importantly, I think it provides you upper bounds on the performance expectations, okay? This is an example of the real application we used and shows you the challenges of this approach, okay? So CCTBX is the common crystallography toolbox. I'll show you more detailed examples later. The point is, it's multi-language C, C++, CUDA, and the driver is in Python, okay? The kernel we use is it's called the NanoBrag. This shows you the cartoon of how the code is composed. There's a bunch of outer loops and parameter, whatever. They set up the inputs and a lot of things happen in Python. At some point, they move to CUDA, okay? So this shows you the real challenges you face when you try to handle the full application, all right? So now, this particular code, and this is actually one of our driving examples, has in the inner loop a call to exp, okay? Turns out that on all the processors, they have specialized hardware instructions for or intrinsics, exp single and double, and you see at least twice the throughput for single versus double. So this is a perfectly good motivating example for our work. And the other applications we have chosen are the same. They call math functions in within the execution, and we know that we have better or faster implementations for that particular math function. In this particular example, that X turns out to be a hotspot, and this is the actual our primitive object with we want to tune around. Okay. Another thing to keep from this, to get from this slide is we associate, so the first thing we do is we associate with a call to the exp with this source line. Okay, and we refer that to as a static source call location. I'll use probably the acronym SLOC from now on. So now, I define what is kind of the code or the instances we wanna optimize for or change the precision. Here's how we go about it, okay? I realized this morning when I was practicing this talk, I don't have a slide that shows you how the tool, the whole tool operates. But we use a performance, we use a trace-based approach. We run the application, we capture all the calls to the exp, we record them. And then we start kind of running analysis on the trace to get the high level information, to try to extract from the trace high level information about the application, all right? So the first thing you can do, so right now, this is a plot of the trace structure. On the x-axis, you have the sequence of the calls. On the y-axis, we plot the static source location associated with each call. And this is an example where you have seven static source call locations, okay? So the first thing you can do, and this is what actually everybody does, you kind of take this graph and you project on the y-axis, okay? And then you end up with considering each call site independently, okay? As I said, this is pretty much what everybody, all the other techniques are kind of doing, okay? But now, if I look at this graph, there's structure in there, okay? Or I think there is structure in there, and it is. And this structure is imposed, as I said, by the iterative nature of the application, okay? So this means I could try to uncover that and try to exploit it, okay? So one of our contributions was this notion that we can exploit this structure, by projecting on the y-axis, which is the source call location. And we can kind of filter and group together elements based on their control flow. So we call this a control flow filtering, okay? And if you do that, you end up with fewer elements, but higher granularity elements, okay? And now this is your unit of tuning rather than individual points on this axis, all right? On top of that, this is good. On top of that, if you look, there is structure or information you can probably uncover and use by projecting on the x-axis, okay? And again, same, the structure comes from the iterative nature of the codes. So we call that exploiting kind of temporal locality information, okay? And again, so this is another contribution of the work. So these two sort of classification and grouping criteria are kind of novel, okay? And turns out that they are very useful in making the technique scalable, okay? Now, how do you go about the control flow filtering? Incidentally, we came up with this independently, but after reading the literature, turns out that Cindy, which is the main author of Pressimonious, she had some follow-on work where she was showing how to do this type of clustering for variables based on data flow information. But they were doing static compile time, we're doing it with dynamic analysis and using control flow data. Anyhow, Cindy was using for her approach generic codes to do community detection on graphs, okay? Very powerful tool. The problem with that is you gotta teach it what a community means. So it's parameterizable and depending on the parameters, it gives you a lot of results, okay? And sometimes, I mean, we experimented with it, we get a lot of clusterings. It's hard to kind of interpret their relationship with the higher level co-structure and the, as I said, the iterative nature, okay? So for example, I'm showing you an example here of a clustering gave by Gerber Newman, which this for the trace before decides these two clusters, these two events are related, then these five events are related. Again, we want to capture the iterative nature of the codes, so we came up with our own homebrew approach, which is actually very simple. So we build the sort of the control flow graph based on the trace. So whenever two elements follow each other, you add an edge, we count the edges, and you end up with this graph. So this graph describes the trace before. And then we have a very simple algorithm that says, okay, iterations are cycles. Let's do cycle detection. We get the cycles, we enumerate them, and we start cutting them from short to large, okay? And if you do that, you end up with this clustering, which is, turns out that captures causality and later the nature of the code better than this one, okay? And this graph is a kind of a summary that says, so on the x-axis, you have the number of experiments. On the y-axis, you have the number of events we can lower using one type of clustering. And this graph says if you do our approach, you do better than this particular clustering. Gervan Newman is gonna give you this clustering eventually, but we have no intuition what the parameters are to get this clustering, okay? The second insight, and this is actually that one of the contributions is how to do the temporal locality based filtering. And the answer very here is very easy. We use backtrace information. So the backtrace associated with the call. And if this graph shows you the same trace as before processed based on backtrace information, the gradient of the same color show you all the backtraces associated with the same static source collocation. And as you can see here, you get much finer grained refinement on the x-axis, and you uncover a lot more structure, okay? On top of that, you can also get the same, I mean, it's obvious. You get the same kind of structure with more refinement on the y-axis. So you can project, you can use this backtrace information and project on both axes, okay? And gives you much finer granularity to think about the application of the, to think about the behavior of an application, all right? This is an example of how a stack trace looks like. The one thing to note here is a lot of C++ followed by a lot of by some Fortran and a lot of C++ again. So this is one of the challenges with big apps. You have a lot of layers and a lot of modules you need to think about. To summarize, these are the traces with which you can split and pick up the objects you want to tune on. So you, you can do the static source location, slow cluster by control flow. You can consider backtraces or backtraces clustered on control flow. If you were to draw a line here in the middle, this is what you can pretty much uncover with static analysis. From now on, you gotta use a kind of dynamic analysis, okay? This is what people were kind of doing so far. We expanded the static into a dynamic, okay? And the one question is if this brings you any value. So I'll show you that it does actually. Search strategy, I'm not gonna talk about it. You can, we have a paper you can read. What I wanna, the only thing you, you need to be aware is we prioritize elements based on their impact on performance. Because of the way we do, the way we, I show you the algorithm is composed, we can afford to sort of do exhaustive search. So, or brute force searches. And we can have some long discussions about the assumptions, but we should not go. We should not go, go over it here. Putting it all together, the question is, how do you build a scalable strategy using this knowledge I just presented to you? So the answer is we use this approach using incremental filtering. So what we do is the following. We start, so we do the clustering based on of static source location based on control flow information that gives us some few objects with large granularity. We tune those, whatever succeeds, succeeded. Whatever is left, we pass it into a next stage of filtering, where we split them into individual static source locations, tune again, succeeds, out, cut. Whatever left, we pass into the third stage, where we start now characterizing on backtraces or dynamic information. Again, coarse grain with clustering, whatever is left over, we move to individual elements. And this is our incremental filtering approach. Because of this continuous filtering, I think we can get away with the brute force, okay? This graph shows you why or what is the impact of this strategy. So on the x-axis, we showed the number of experiments. On the y-axis, we showed the number of events lower from the trace for this particular example. So this is a metric of how good the transformation is, okay? And what you wanna do is you're gonna go up as fast as possible, okay? And there's a lot of information hidden in this graph, but for the purposes of this talk is, what you, this incremental filtering takes you the fastest to the solution, okay? And for comparison, I would say previous techniques, if you were to apply, they stop here, okay? They will stop here, okay? So we can probably do better, we are more aggressive than previous techniques, okay? So this is how the methodology works. Now the question is, what happens when you apply it to applications? And this is where we are right now. Looks like I'm at 50 minutes. I'm gonna spend 5 more minutes, okay? So CCTBX, it is computational crystallography, again, complicated code, Python. What you looked at is the NanoBragg kernel. The output of this code is a 3000 by 3000 pixel image. And this is how they judge correctness. We went to the application developers and they said, if you give me a few pixels difference on about 10 inputs, I'll take it, okay? So So we attain 1 pixel difference and we use 20 inputs, so they were happy with that. The profile data says it spends 14% of its execution in exponentials. There's few static sites. One dominates. We did the refactoring. We get, 27% speed up on the Volta because we managed to lower the heavy site. We were lucky. This is a simple code, and static information is kind of enough to lower the most of the static call sites. The changes have been adopted in the application because being an image, they go to float to integer, and then it's kind of robust, and they believe the result. The second one is PeleC, the PeleC combustion suite, which is an AMR-based code for simulation of reacting flows. Super complicated combination of Python, C++, and Fortran. The module we looked at is this premix flame computation. It has a 1-2D formulation. The output is the flame speed. When we went back to the developers, turned out that they don't have a clear idea what the correctness was. First, they said, 10 to minus 6 absolute error. They had an internal discussion. They changed that to relative 10% error. This is our results here. We are good on both metrics. Based on the feedback I got from Mark Day, this discussion was actually very useful for them because it forced them to think about the acceptability and correctness. And they're going to have to think about it when they move to tensor cores and so on. If you look at the profile, spends 16% or 5%. We get 8% and 3% speed up because we recuperate enough. We can lower enough. The interesting part on this code is shows actually that also the challenges. So the code exercise is 7 static sites, 2 in the 2 in some Fortran code, 5 in C++ code. If you go back to the application, the Fortran calls are in this module. And if you look, there's total 6 calls of exp in that file. So 2 out of 6, we're good, we got enough coverage. We can probably do the rest of the 4, okay? The problem is this. So this C++ code, we exercise 5 out of 250 call sites, but let's say this is not a problem. The real problem is this. This C++ code is generated by a Python domain generator, okay? And then changing things here and trying to convince people to adopt them is probably tricky. So this is both a challenge and an opportunity. You ask me, if you're a grad student looking for a thesis, this could be a great topic. How do I do precision tuning at the domain generator level and make it like stick and permeate through the code generation? And to me, this is a very interesting idea. Refactoring. We got these results. The question, how you go put them back in the application? Tricky. You got to be very aware. We have some tools that recommend the strategy to you. So this shows you what the challenge is. So it's path divergence. So this example says a G can be executed on the orange and green paths in float and on the purple path in double. The question is how you refactor. We can give you some analysis based on path and based on the backtraces that tells you what the minimal point is. And then, but then you got to decide what is the strategy, okay? So you can either clone all the nodes that on the path, and that solves the problem, or you can even go with a strategy that kind of marks the path and tests for divergence, okay? The choice is yours. You also need to be performance aware because, I mean, this marking and these tests, you want to keep them aware. You want to keep them out of loops, okay? So because you don't want to put ugly conditionals in loops. So summary, so we kind of shown some of the new ideas here. We've shown how to incorporate the control flow and the temporal locality into precision tuning. You really need this for full application tuning. The tool is robust, it's been tested. As I said, there are challenges when you need to go back to a super complicated application. But one of the benefits is you can use this for fast exploration, figure out if it's even worth, the thought process is even worth. So it gives you an upper bound on the potential benefits. Again, refactoring is tricky. And one lesson we learned, and actually we learned this lesson with Press Simonis as well. So I don't know if Jimmy is still online, but the trickiest thing to figure out is what is the actual formal correctness criteria for an application. And for the image-based one, it was kind of simple. Turned out that for Pele, they are still debating it. And I think they're open to a dialogue with us as well. In terms of future directions, we have three things that are promising. So one is more doing like a full exercise, move a bunch of NISEP applications to Tensor Core. And I think the candidates right now is Asgard and SuperLU. And when you do this, you're gonna use the combination of Presimonious GPU mixer as an inner like kernel tuner, and our PyFlot as a meta tuner for the whole application. The other one, which I'm actually, I just figured out how to do it. And it, if we're gonna work on it over the summer, and if we do it, it's gonna be a very good result. Both, I mean, academically in terms of program analysis and in terms of techniques, is to try and figure out how to tune arrays, okay? So I can take your array, can tell you, keep this region in single, keep this region in double. The third one is collaboration with Riverside. We're gonna try to apply a ML for error prediction. It's probably a powerful tool that doesn't require insight. So learns about your application, your training inputs, doesn't have any insight in floating point behavior, but based on the way you run it, we can probably tell you errors. And then the third direction, which was raised by the Pele example, is that's probably worth thinking about the interaction in between domain generators, the generated code, and precision tuning. Okay. And that's it. Thank you. The work has been funded by NERSC, and we're going to keep doing it for the rest, at least of this calendar year, but I think we want to keep it alive, because we are on to some problems that I actually find entertaining. And I think Hugo also has interest, and there's other interest from the outside the community. And thank you. Questions?